The United States is a nation of great cultural diversity. In this video, we would like to tell you about one small community, the African-American community of Johnstown, Pennsylvania, located some 70 miles east of Pittsburgh in the Allegheny Mountains. Johnstown, which is located in the midst of some massive coal fields, is a modest-sized city whose economy is based on steelmaking. In the last century, the famous Cambria Ironworks and the Johnson Rail Company were the dominant industries here. In this century, the real story of work has been the story of Bethlehem Steel, with its huge, fully integrated mills, at times employing some 17,000 men and women. That, to a very large extent, is Johnstown's story. While African Americans have been in Johnstown since the 1870s, there have been two significant migrations from the South to Johnstown in this century. One was during World War I, and the other was in the years surrounding and including 1923 and 1924. You're about to hear accounts from people who were part of these migrations and whose lives cover some 75 years of local history. Practically, we can say, it is the story of the entire century. The story of African Americans here is somewhat complex, even though the community itself was likely never larger than 3,000 people. While the migrations from the South were clearly stimulated by deteriorating economic conditions and by boll weevil problems which beset the cotton crops in the first part of the century, the connections and the attractions to Johnstown are varied and interesting.
We were from Georgia, the northern part of Georgia, a place called Lafayette, but the neighbors called it Lafette. It was a farming community and predominantly black. We farmed, the eight of us, with my mother and dad being the leaders of the family, and we had other relatives in that area and are still there in this town of Lafayette. We left there for economic reasons, and we came to Johnstown, where my father secured employment, which is known as Bethlehem Steel.
I came from a family of 10 children. My parents and 10 children. We originally came out of the state of Georgia, Carroll County. However, my father was a little more than a tenant farmer. He leased his land from the landlord. And his profits and loss, he had to absorb himself. I remember us having two mules, wagons, all of our equipment, and a Model T Ford, which back in those days would be very rare for black people to have, you understand? As far as my mother was concerned, she was a typical black housewife. She took good care of her family, and that was her main concern, to take care of the family. The Southern routine is the woman stays at home, cook for the children, and the father, with whatever children that was big enough to go to the field with him, would go out and work the fields. I came up here at the age of 5. I remember at the age of 4, my father gave me a sugar sack, a 25-pound sugar sack. That was the beginning of my work. I picked cotton in that 25-pound sugar sack. I was only 4 years old. I remember reaching up at the bowls. I had to reach up to get the bowl, to pull the cotton off the stalk.
My parents came here, my dad and mother came here. They were originally from Virginia, mother from a small town 10 miles from Winchester called Berryville. My dad was from West Virginia, right across the line from her home. And they came to Johnstown from Cumberland in 1908. My grandfather, whom I, even to the day, I'm sorry that I never talked to him a lot about his background, but my grandfather was a slave. He had been a slave, and he farmed. In fact, he worked at a farm that was right next door to the property where we lived then, and which is still in the family. And my grandmother was born in just out of slavery, 1865. My parents were at that particular time domestics. There were many, or quite a number, I should say, of black chauffeurs, mainly working for people in Westmont, of which my dad, during his lifetime, had been one. He'd been a chauffeur, butler. My mother lived in, and that's why probably why my brother was born in a large apartment building in Kernville, which is like 100 yards from where I live right now, and in 1914. My sister was born in Westmont.
My name is Ruth Whitehead, and I came from Clayton, Alabama. My father was here first. He came ahead of us until he got a job, and we came in 1920. We lived in Cambria City, and my uncle was the pastor of the Shiloh Baptist Church at Rosedale. So he moved, and we moved too, out at Rosedale. That's where my life, childhood was lived in Rosedale until I was married.
They were recruiting people all over the country to work in the steel mill here in Johnstown, and also they were building the city sewer system. So since he was a plumber, he moved his young family to Johnstown and worked as on the city sewer system. But being a black person, he did not, the only thing he was allowed to do was to dig ditches. So he saw that and he went in the mill.
My father's name was Robert Joseph Quarles. My mother's name was Georgiana Harris. And he once worked in a lime factory in Hartford, South Carolina, before he started sharecropping of his own. And he did that up until the time of his death in 1917.
One of the things that might interest you is the actual migration from the South to Johnstown. The main reason for that migration, which was massive, was economics. And it's the strangest thing that I remember. My parents were caught up in that too. And I, as a three-year-old, was on this train loaded with people. And to me, it was fascinating at three. And I can remember the steam and the men putting the coal on the train. But the main thing to remember is the reason we came was economics. Because at that time, remember, the boll weevil was king in the South. And another thing, the South was no longer the cotton crop country of the world. California had replaced it. And then the mechanical picker came into being. So labor was at a low ebb, and the times were just too hard for people to make it. So we migrated north.
My father was in the First World War. He got out in 1918, and he came up here in 1919 or 20. And he had a wife and a son. And my sister and I were born in Franklinboro. That's where he lived. And he came up on his own. He wasn't one of those people who were brought up here to work in the mill. I mean, he came on his own, him and his, he He had a brother, and he had this brother-in-law. Two brother-in-law came up, and him and his brother and their families came up. And he got a job in Bethel Steel, and he worked there. First, he worked out at the wheel plant that was at lower end of Franklin Borough. And he worked out there for quite a while, I guess up until the 30s.
My father came the first part of 1923. He had a brother living here. And the farms were going from bad to worse, and he could never get out of debt. And his brother was working in the steel mill. It was called Cambria Works. It wasn't Bethlehem Steel, it was Cambria Works or something. Right. And he sent from my father's brother, who had just come in that area from Texas. He lived in Texas, and he abhorred farming. So, and then it was four of us and just the one of him, so my uncle sent for my father's brother first. And then in several months, they got enough money together, and they sent for my father. And I remember distinctly when my father sent for the three of us. It was a Monday after Easter.
Now let me tell you a little bit about where these people who migrated, where they lived. Our family at first lived in Morrellville with a relative. Later on, we moved to Prospect. But the majority of the people who migrated here lived in Minersville and Rosedale, which was close to their work. Later on, there was another group of people that went to Franklin and Conemaugh, again, close to Bethlehem Steel. So you see, the reason they went and stayed so close together was lack of transportation and could walk very easily to work. Let me tell you about the one that I know of most, Minersville, which was a few miles from Rosedale. There were people everywhere. There were no empty lots or empty houses. Houses were under the bridges. People lived with each other. And it was a community all to itself. There was pool rooms and bars, and work was plentiful. The people were all together and having a good time, but underlying the biggest thing was they were economically more better off than when they left the South years ago. But to have seen that community in those days, it's unbelievable.
With the increased population of blacks coming in, being recruited to work in the mills, they had to have a place for them to stay. And of course, they branched out. Now, most of them you would find in the Conemaugh Borough, Franklin Borough, Rosedale, Minersville area. They were predominantly black. But every now and then when I came to Prospect, I think the entire colored residential section was about four or five black families.
Well, I'd like to tell you a little about Rosedale, where I was really raised at. We moved out there in 1920. Beforehand, we had lived in Cambria City, but my uncle got a job at the Rosedale Baptist Church, and so all our relatives moved, and we did too. And while we were there, the Bethlehem started bringing in Mexicans, Negroes by transportation, until I think about 1923. We had our one school, and we had a Baptist church in Rosedale, and a two-room schoolhouse. We had two black teachers, One was Miss Norma, she was from the Washington, D.C., and one was Professor Swanston. They had, at one time, they had a, the hunters had a club up at the upper end, and then they dammed up the creek and they had made a little swimming hole out there.
A lot of people moved to Rosedale from other sections of Johnstown. They worked in Bethlehem Steel. Cambria was Cambria Steel at that time. It was beautiful. They supplied us with coal, wood during the winter by having a couple of carloads of coal dumped along the tracks from up to down the hall all the way up. Wood the same. We kids used to go up with bags and load the coal and wood up and roll it down the tracks to our home. Later on, we get it, put it in our coal bins. But Rosedale was a beautiful place at that time. We had, I would say, store across the creek up the holler named Simmons Store, owned by Black. They had a store further up called Payton. It was owned by a white man. But we traded at different stores. Payton had more of a supplies of different varieties of food than Simmons. Simmons was a smaller store, but we got along well. We had one black church, a Baptist church. Pastor was Reverend Robinson. We had two schools, a black school and a white school. And we seemed to get along. We never had any racial problems or nothing like that. The school, when you was out of school, you was right, just like in this yard and that yard. That's how close the schools were together. But we never had any problems with names calling, nothing like that.
We were put into what we call in the steel mills hot jobs. Low pay and very hot, mainly the blast furnace and the coke plant. Now those jobs were mainly relegated to this black migratory person who came here from the South to better himself. Well, he did. I think morally, financially, he was bettered, even though his wages were lower than his counterparts, the whites. Those men took those menial jobs and made them into something that was proud. If you would see those men using those shovels and brooms and shoveling that hot coke and using skill to do it, please believe me, it takes skill not to get burned up shoveling coke 3 or 4 feet high or flame jumping 10 feet high. And those men did it. It was survival, but we made the best of it.
The worst job was sealing lids with the, on the top, yeah. I forget what the temperature was up there. You wore wooden shoes. You had five lids with fire coming out of each one of them. They had a larry, what they called a larry car, which brought the coal out on this block and then dumped it in the in these holes, and then you pushed these lids on afterwards and sealed it up with mud. And of course, it's smoke, gas, fumes. Terrible way to make a living. Guys from different departments, you know, used to like to tell you how much more money they made than you, because the coke plant wasn't, I mean, unless you were lucky enough to work in a department where you were working maybe piecework, coke plant wasn't at the top of the list when it came to making money. In fact, blast furnace made more money, the blast furnace employees made more money than the coke plant workers. Personally, I always used to look at some of my fellow black workers, and I used to think that, almost wish that I was like them, because so many of them, they seemed that is, the older people, not the younger ones. They seemed content, they seemed happy, they would sing at work and everything else, you know, me, it was a different story.
From the time that the Copeland rejuvenated from your depression, I would say, with the exceptions of the foreman and the heater, the rest of the personnel, I'd say it was about 80% black. The reason why your black people was in the steel mill, do you know, if you went in the steel mill and actually worked all your time, your wages were just about what school teachers were, or maybe slightly higher.
When I started working in Westmount, it was 27 black chauffeurs on Westmount. And I happened to be the last chauffeur off of Westmount. Now, we don't count the Bethlehem and Crown American. That's a company, but I mean personal chauffeurs for families. There were so many porters' jobs in the stores and hotels, and practically all the hotels had waiters. The chambermaids was colored. So you got along fine. I knew nothing about a depression, but I lived just as well. Understand what I'm saying now, because everything was much cheaper. But as far as the living, I lived just as well then, because I always, since I was old enough to own the car, always owned an automobile. A nice one, not no shabby one. So therefore, I can't say I had a depression. There was a depression, but myself and my family, I can truthfully say, they lived well. I started at Sonny Hanna at 36. They didn't even have a black bartender for years and years after you were a waiter or anything else. They had black chefs and everything, but you didn't tend bar. I have been offered a job as manager. Fitz, you hear him, before he left, he was offered me, but it's too much a headache. They'll give you a job up there at anything you can do. They didn't tell you, but they let you know, but not if you apply for the job, it's always taken.
Well, that's where the money was. So they were paying me $7 a week. And I was, $100 was a whole lot of money then. It wasn't no problem for me to get $100 a week. The reason I didn't go in the mill, I could have gone in the mill. A lot of guys asked me to come in the mill. So they told me what they were making. I was making more and didn't get dirty in a week than they were getting every 2 weeks. So I couldn't see that. The reason I went in the mill was when the war started. I got a letter from the War Manpower Commission. They told me that I had to either get an... claimed that was an essential job, non-essential. I had to get an essential job or go into service. And I hadn't left nothing in the service, and I didn't want to go there, so I went on in the mill. I worked in the mill 10 years and 2 months. It wasn't hard. I mean, the guys around me, they were complaining all the time. I don't know what for, but it wasn't too bad.
When I came out of high school, there was no jobs around here for the black girls there, unless they went up on Westmount to do domestic work. So I decided, I had a few friends in New York, and I went to New York, did housework for I think it was about 6 months, and then I came back. I did work on when they had those adult classes. I was one of the teachers, and it was held in Rosedale and in Minersville. I'd go to Rosedale in the morning and go down in Minersville in the afternoon. After I was married for a few years, I went to work in the dress factory, which is called Goldstein Levine, and I worked there for a good many years. The first time I went there, I only stayed 1 year because they didn't have a union, and they just treated you, and you didn't get very good pay, so I quit. And I went back when the union came in the 40s. A few girls got to be seamsters. Mm-hmm. But their piece rates were terrible. They didn't never want to give you nothing. That's the reason we had so many stoppages. That's the only way we could make them do something about it. We stopped. But the white girls, they were afraid. But we didn't care because it was a hot job, and you cannot sell a dress unless it's pressed the way they said. So now I pick up dresses now. We had to open all seams. Everything had to be perfect for the little money they was giving you. Couldn't make a lot.
When I came back after the war and went back to my job, they had to put you back on the job you left on. That was first shepherd. I worked about 2 months for a shepherd, keeper's job come out. We had union and everything. I moved up to keeper. And I was keeping in Bethel for about 32 years. A keeper's job, you're over all the jobs on the front. It's your responsibility to see those jobs is taken care of and done right. Keeper's job is to tap the furnace for sinners. That's what they call slag. And flush that off before cast time. Cast time, keep his job to tap the tapping hole for the iron. In Cameron steel time, it was like heaven down low camp. Everybody got along down there. Bosses, white, black. It was much different in low Cameron Franklin as it was in white and black. He was treated like a dog, I said, frankly, until they got a union. Then they got a little better. But they never got good, not in Franklin. We always got along good down in the Cameron. Oh, it was your living. It was everything. Without it, we couldn't have survived. Just at that time, if I'd been working hotel, I couldn't have supported a family, not as I did in the mill, because as Bob McIntyre had told me, things would change from a hotel when the price of steel go up, cost of living go up, which I love the mill. I come out underage, not because I hated or disliked the job.
For the African American community of Johnstown, Pennsylvania, the 20th century has been an experience of both considerable struggle and a good deal of success. The people you have seen have given us a glimpse of Southern life, of their migration north, of the formation of neighborhoods, and of the work of both men and women in the period between the Great Wars. But there is more to this story, because life involved much more than work and its economic rewards. For Johnstown's African-American community, it was family life, combined with the most important of all institutions, the church, which gave life its center, its meaning. Future portraits of the cultural experience of the African-Americans of Johnstown, Pennsylvania, will involve these themes.